And I welcome all the panel members. Good afternoon, everybody. All the audience, we still have 126 participants. So the people have patience with time. So I think this is a very very relevant topic and very interesting topic. I'll just share my thoughts and the way I propose to structure. My request is we spend all the panel members to spend 5 minutes to share the thoughts with the audience, and then we can, if we are still having some more time, we will take the question and answers. This being the last session, we don't have anybody you know waiting after us. So depending upon the comfort of the people, we can take a call, you know, after the discussion is done. So just to set the stage. I was doing my own notes, you know, yesterday. Was talking to my colleagues, and the relevance of the circular economy and the topic itself, I think it is the perfect time to discuss the GCCA. First of all, I mean, you know, thank you to Kaustav and GCCA, you know, for organizing this conference and having discussion on the topics, you know, which are very relevant. So one of these study, the Alan MacArthur Foundation study, I was looking at, and they were talking about a transformation, a circular economy transformation in India, and the potential for the transformation. So some of the numbers, you know, which are really helpful to understand the potential. They were talking about 624 billion value creation in terms of the money terms, you know, if we go in for the circular economy transformation by 2050, and 44% reduction in the greenhouse gas emission. This is over and above the roadmap, you know, whatever we have. The government of India is working on multiple things. This is the potential. The circular economy transformation brings it into the play, and the advantages, you know, economic advantages and the environmental advantages, you know, which come out of it. Specifically for the climate change, you know, with the 44% reduction. The cement industry as such in India, we feel proud, you know, all the member companies of the GCCA and the companies, you know, which are not member of GCCA, but the part of the Indian cement industry. We have done very well, remarkably well in the last 20-25 years when it comes to practicing the best practices, you know, which are available. In terms of the energy efficiency, in terms of the quality of cement, in terms of blended cement production, usage of the alternative fuel, waste heat recovery, even looking at, you know, the materials like red mud and other waste materials, you know, coming from elsewhere and the other industries to use it in the cement manufacturing. So it's a remarkable thing in terms of the CO2 emission itself. If you look at it, one of the NCB studies, it says in 1996, on an average, India was generating 1.12 ton of CO2, which has come down to 0.6 ton of CO2 in 2017. So that's, we have come to roughly, you know, 50% improvement in terms of the specific CO2 emission per ton of cement production. But then it's only the part of the cement, and then we have the concrete also, which is we just now in the day, during the day, we heard about the session on the carbon cure, where the CO2 injection can be done in the concrete, and the technology is available even as we talk to produce net zero concrete. So with that, I would just sum up, you know, it's the collaboration which is the key basically for the circular economy transformation, and GCCA and Innovendi as part of the GCCA are doing pretty good. We need to look at the collaboration where we learn from the other industries, like Diksha was talking about the aluminium industry, and we are going to discuss about the other conglomerate Dr. Ashok, you know, about the SABIC, you know, which they have done a lot of work on the circular economy. So the private companies, manufacturing companies, technology suppliers, associations, R&D institutes, academia in India, the IITs and the IIMs, the government bodies, and then GIZ and other government companies, you know, associated with the various global governments, the role they have to play in terms of the collaboration and looking at something, as my friend, you know, just said that there is no planet B and there is no plan B. But so we all have to work together for the concept, you know, which is the circular economy, and look for technologies and innovations where we curb the climate change and we look for a greener planet. So I would move to the with that note, move to our first panelist, Dr. Ashok, to share his thoughts onto the circular economy and as a conglomerate, what SABIC has done or is doing right now, specifically, you know, for the one of the initiative, you know, they have is the True Circle portfolio and services. Specific to that, how does it impact, you know, the in terms of the products, you know, what SABIC is doing, and how we can take those lessons and some of the ideas into the cement industry. Over to you, Dr. Ashok.
Sure. Thank you. Thanks a lot, Mr. Manoj. First of all, I would like to thank Costa for the kind introduction, and also would like to thank GCC and entire organizing committee for inviting SABIC to this forum to share our thoughts. I would also like to compliment the entire team for putting up such a wonderful show. The quality of speakers and the content has been pretty rich. And again, this section also, and the previous section of asking people from different industry to come and share their thoughts on circular economy, that itself is wonderful, because as many of the speakers have spoken in the past, in which I echo, that this problem of climate change cannot be solved by one particular group. It is a collective actions that needs to be taken. We need to collaborate and move forward. So thanks a lot. And as mentioned by Manoj, I will be sharing a little bit of what SABIC is doing on circular economy. SABIC, as many of you know, is one of the largest diversified chemical companies. We make chemicals, polymers, agri-nutrients, and even metals, as a matter of fact. And today, what I will try to link some of our activities to cement industries. Not just I can share, I have also learned a lot listening to what's been shared so far. So coming back to plastics and polymers, we all know by 2020, our planet will be a home to almost 10 billion people. And it's hard to imagine how we can live without plastics. So plastics is vital for day-to-day life. Plastics are light, durable, safe, and it has transformed the life on the earth, as we all have seen. We've used plastic to preserve food. We have used plastic to make medical, life-saving medical equipments, lighter vehicles, greener building. And even in the current pandemic situation, we all know that this is the material which is saving lives of so many COVID warriors. However, the user is endless, but however, the problem of plastic waste has become one of the society's biggest and most important challenges. So this very problem overshadows the benefit that plastics brings to our civilization. And the question facing today's society is, what is it that we can do to ensure durable processing of plastic waste? And as a leader in this industry, SABIC believes in addressing these issues. Sustainability is at the top of our agenda. And in order to kind of meet our sustainability goals, we have set across key priorities, which is based upon our materiality issues that we have identified. And these include resource efficiency, climate change and energy, environmental health and safety, innovation and sustainable solutions, since we do make a lot of materials, governance and integrity, that goes without saying, and circular economy. And all these priorities are linked to 10 out of 17 United Nations development goals. Now, I will today stress more on circular economy aspect of our priorities. Now, driving circular economy, which is based on principle of decoupling economic growth from linear use of natural resources and its environmental impact, becomes extremely important in closing the loop. And as mentioned by Manoj, SABIC has initiated this True Circle initiative, which we consider as a milestone in our journey in closing the loop and creating a circular economy. And it's our vision to kind of keep plastics always in use and try to keep remaking plastics rather than letting it go into waste. So we would like to make it into new products. We would like to make and never have plastics get into our ecosystem or oceans as such. Now, True Circle case study, if I say, it has four pillars, the True Circle initiatives. The first pillar is a flagship circular recycles product that we make using difficult to recycle mixed plastic waste. So the first pillar is all about collecting mixed plastic waste, recycling them into a feedstock, which can be fed back into our cracker stove. So when polymers are made, we utilize feedstocks, and pretty much these are fossil waste. And attempt here is to kind of substitute portion of fossil fuel with these mixed plastic waste, which are converted by pyrolyzing them, converting them into an oil, and getting it back into our cracker, starting with lower quantity and continuously increasing as we go. And the second pillar is looking at renewable feedstock or the bio feedstock. And when I talk about bio feedstock, these are primarily looking at waste generated from paper and pulp industry, which doesn't interfere with our food chain. And we call it the second generation bio-based feedstock, which are again, these feedstocks are again converted into oil and fed into our crackers. And the reason why we are doing this is because if you look at many regulations starting with Europe, there is a push for starting to use recycled and renewable content into the plastic packaging. And this is one of the best ways which actually closes the loop and brings in circularity. And what we also add to these productions are a certification process. So we use ISCC certified polymers. So there is this external agency which certifies us. This is based upon the mass balance approach and takes into consideration the chain of custody approach. And this is a well-recognized certification agency where a lot of countries have recognized this. And based on this, we are able to sell our products, certified circular products across the globe. Third pillar, of course, looking at mechanical recycling. And the fourth pillar is more to look at design for recyclability. How do you kind of ensure that we are designing our products which can be recycled easily? How are we able to design our resins and polymers which can intake a lot more post-consumer recycled content? And over and above certification, what we also do is strictly use processes or concepts like life cycle assessment to ensure that we are making informed decisions. Life cycle, as many of you are aware, is a very well-known tool which is used to study the environmental impact of any process, products, and services. And we have used this life cycle assessment tool to look at how much is the reduction that we are bringing about for our GHG footprint by using renewable and recycled like mixed plastic waste. So in this particular case, what we have figured out is that we could reduce 4 kgs of CO2 per kgs of resin when it comes to a renewable feedstock. And in case of mixed plastic waste, we could clearly see around 2 kgs of CO2 reduction in this case. But another very important initiative that we have taken a few years back, which is very relevant to cement industry, is that SABIC, a couple of years back, or a few years back, actually built world's largest carbon dioxide capture and purification plant. So this carbon dioxide capture and purification plant can, on an annual basis, purify around 500,000 ton of carbon dioxide. So the SABIC has, as I said, we make a lot of polymers and chemicals. So this plant is made next to a chemical plant which produces ethylene glycol. And the carbon dioxide that is being emitted from this plant is captured by this purification plant. This carbon dioxide is purified and also liquefied, and it is channeled into other chemical plants belonging to SABIC for making useful chemicals. So one of the channel goes to for making urea. As I said, SABIC also makes agri-nutrients, and one of the key components of that is urea. So this carbon dioxide is channeled to make urea. This carbon dioxide is channeled to make methanol, and the liquefied carbon dioxide even goes for food and beverage industry. So this is a good start and a great example of how carbon dioxide can be captured and used for making useful products. And I think this is pretty relevant when it comes to cement industries. We all understand that there's a lot of good work that is happening in cement industry, but the biggest issue in carbon dioxide emission comes from the chemistry that happens in your cement kiln. If you're converting calcium carbonate to calcium oxide, the carbon dioxide release is always a challenge. So what do you kind of look at it? Definitely processes like CCU and CCS, if any company is looking at carbon neutrality going up to, let's say, by 2050, or trying to look at science-based targets, it becomes absolutely important to look at processes like this. Even for SABIC, not just carbon capture, we are also looking at going forward, if you want to continue to look at carbon neutrality, it becomes important for us to even consider electrification of our furnaces, and I'm sure similar approaches is also being addressed. Now, all these cannot happen alone. So we actually collaborate with a lot of organizations and companies, including our peers, to develop this technology to meet our requirement. And I'm sure for those who are following the recent G20 summit, which was organized in Saudi Arabia, and SABIC was a part was helping the government of PSA organizing G20, and I was fortunate enough to be assisting in few workshops. And one of the key themes of this particular G20 summit was looking at circular carbon economy. And this circular carbon economy is all about looking at CCU and CCS. And as a matter of fact, in September 2020, the energy ministers met and endorsed that the circular carbon economy is an integral and inclusive approach to transitioning towards comprehensive, resilient, sustainable, and climate-friendly energy systems that supports and enables sustainable development. That we would be seeing more of these coming forward. With this, I would stop now, and I think pass it to the back to the moderator.
Thank you, Dr. Menon. Thank you, Dr. Menon, for I think a couple of good ideas on the carbon capture and utilization, and also on the recycling of the plastic, because in India, as Mr. Pallikar was talking about, you know, we have the cement industry, you know, we have got a lot of bag cement which we sell into the market. And then these bags mostly are plastic bags. So they need to be, we need to work on, you know, technologies and ways, you know, to recycle that. Fantastic. So thank you very much.